I don't know what to do. You really messed me up for that intro, you know, Barry.
Why?
I just don't know what
to do. Tell me to do it.
Go on, let Barry do an intro.
Welcome back to another episode of the NPK show.
You're not doing Formula One racing.
Is this the podcast?
I said the
NPK show. It's not. It's a fucking podcast, mate.
Podcast, yeah.
Podcast. Just do it, hurry up, lad.
You're not, like, commentating to the...
And he's off him and we go and he's in first place and he's, oh, and he's lost it. Come on.
Is that your idea of horse racing commentary?
Fucking car auction.
NPK. The NPK show. NPK. To all the listeners around the world.
Hello there, listeners. What's going on? Podcast 154.
What an intro, Stephen.
I know, I thought I'd mix it up a little bit.
Yeah.
You're with myself, Stephen.
And myself, Barry.
And it is 154, and we're doing Coco, Soil, Perlite, Vermiculite, Rockwool, Jiffies, 6040, Pebbles, all the media that you... What did I miss?
See the list again. I bet you can't.
And we're doing Coco 6040, soil with perlite, pebbles, rockwool cubes, and did we see water is a medium? It's a bit of a follow on from last week's podcast.
Yeah.
So water itself is a medium, but you've got a lot of other mediums as well. So we're going to be talking about Coco, soil, and all. I'm not going to do the list again, the list all again, Barry. But
I'd do it.
I wouldn't. They'll get bored.
You can't do it again. I forgot.
So basically, it's for all you media growers and what is going on with all the media and how to use it, some common mistakes, some top tips from myself and Barry, and how to get the most out of your grow if you're using media.
Yeah, man.
In Liverpool, which is where we are, in the UK, the biggest media sales are in Coco.
Yeah.
It's just massive. I think around the UK as well, though, media, Coco is the biggest sellers.
Yeah, most definitely.
And the range of cocos that you've got, you go from, in my opinion, one of the lower-end cocos, you've got your Coco Natural, your CANNA, and then you've got your high-end Coco Professional Plus, and you've got Mills with the DNA
cork,
with the Coco with cork, and you've got everything in between. You've got Dutch Pro Coco, you've got Atami, you've got Gold Labels. 60,
Atami is 20% soil, though, isn't it?
It is. It's a blend, isn't
Don't
it?
Include that in Coco. Then. We'll talk about that separately.
Oh, as a special
edition. As a special edition.
Okay.
Because it is special.
It is. So you were looking at the history of Coco. Tell us all about the history of Coco, Barry.
I forgot it now. I was looking at Canna's website and had a little look on that. And it is, do you know what coconut it comes from?
The coconut.
What one, though? Is there a variety?
There probably is, yeah, but I don't know.
An Indian coconut.
An Indian coconut?
An Indian coconut.
So that's what cocoa fibres they use?
Yeah.
Because if you don't know, they use coconuts, recycled fibres, and the waste from harvesting coconuts we reuse. So we're a very green industry, aren't we?
It is, isn't it?
If you use cocoa, you're saving the planet.
Yeah.
Because that just goes to waste otherwise. If you're a cocoa grower, some top tips. Coco's very good at holding on to water. So if we said last week you can't overwater, but with Coco, you can very easily push out the air spaces. If you put too much water through, it holds on to the water.
Yeah.
And if your plant isn't established enough to drink that quick enough, then you're going to push out all the oxygen out of the air, with the spaces in between.
That's because it's like a lighter mix than soil, isn't it?
There's less
sponge more.
Yeah. And it's going to hold
on. Which is good for mature plants, but for younger plants,
it's not so good. If you're going to use Coco, then bear in mind what size of pot that you're going to pot up into as well. Don't just go to a tiny plant and go straight into a 30-litre pot.
No.
Because what a mistake that a lot of people make is that they're going to water the Coco rather than water the plant.
Yeah.
So when you water the Coco in a 30-litre pot, you're going to end up putting litres and litres and litres through it, whereas the plant only probably wants 250ml of water. Yeah. When it's
and then we sat there now waiting to do the 5 litres to just dry out naturally.
Even we do it when we're potting up, and if we're doing any experiments and it's in a big cocoa pot, you do tend to want to saturate all the cocoa. It just feels better. Yeah, give that a good soak, and the plant's only 2 inches big. So pot up small, especially in cocoa, pot up small, let the root mass fill the pot, and then pot up in stages. And that way you're not going to be laid into the mistake of watering your cocoa rather than watering the plant. What's your top tip for cocoa? You were saying, I know this is like a pebbles. I know, I don't want to catch it out. Your top tip before was with pebbles, wasn't it?
I always, with cocoa, I always put it in about an inch and a half of pebbles on the bottom of the pot. But that's mainly because I like bottom feeding.
Yeah.
That's what that's mainly for. So
I've
it's
heard
not
that
when
from
it's
a few people.
That's mainly because just as the plant gets older, I like to just bottom feed. I'll never put what, once I've teased them roots to the bottom, then.
You love a good bottom feed.
Yeah, I love
you,
a good bottom. I love a good tease and a good bottom feed. That sounds terrible, that Stephen. Have you just said that? But I do. I put an inch and a half weight of pebble on the bottom because I never top feed. Once them roots are at the bottom, that's me.
I'm a bottom feeder.
Yeah, I love it.
The thing with bottom feeding is that in individual sources, you're giving the plants exactly what they want.
Yeah, I'll tend to stay away from using the 1 meter and the 1.2 trays. I'll be dead honest with you, Steve. And that's only for that fact that if I've got four plants now sat in cocoa and I've got my pebble on the bottom, then if I, let's just say for once of a better thing, about 10 litres in that tray, one plant might be thirstier than the other. And by the time it's gone because that one plant's drank it, the other three plants are suffering then as a result. They're not hitting the full potential, are they? Yeah. So it is.
And some will just end up sat in that water.
Some of them will end up sat in the water. You could end up leaving it. But for the plants that aren't getting, like, they still could be drinking. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And you're not. They'll still end up hungry, but that one's full. Overfair. If that makes, yeah.
So with the pebbles at the bottom, when you're giving the water through the bottom, then if that cocoa's right at the very bottom, it's going to wick up really quickly and it absorbs
right up, yeah.
I'm going to use the word overwater because it's just easy and everyone understands it. But
now, I'll put the inch and a half weight of pebble on the bottom because when I put the water in it, it's not absorbing right up the cocoa, so it's keeping some of the air in that pot, and all the main roots at the bottom, which are between the pebbles, are happy to drink it.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Water roots at the bottom, which means that they love to drink that part of the root. In the middle section of the root is your water and your air root, so
and
they take water air.
The very top is your air root,
exactly,
isn't it?
Yeah, so you don't want to keep them drenched because that's the part of the root that's going to take up as much oxygen as possible.
Yeah, that's it.
I like to do, whereas Barry puts pebbles in the bottom and I do the same, I also, on hot occasions, which it is now in the summer, I'll put a layer of pebbles on the top. And this does two things. If you are top feeding, if you put pebbles on the top, those that are a little bit overzealous, they're a little bit excited when they start watering, you just start leathering the water all over the top. If you ever noticed when you top feed and you're aggressive with it, that it looks as though the cocoa's shrinking in the pot.
Yeah.
Well, it is. It's because you're pushing all of the air out and the cocoa settles, and eventually you're ending up with a basically compressed brick of cocoa, and the roots hate that because they want lots of oxygen, they want lots of air spaces. So when you put the pebbles on the top and you top feed, even if you are a little bit overzealous, then it's not going to compress as much because it's hitting the pebbles face
and
disperse
it properly. Yeah.
The cocoa. The other benefit of it is in gardening, they call it mulching. So they put a layer of organic matter on the top, and on hot days, when you've watered the plants, the water doesn't evaporate. So it's not even getting to the plant roots, it's just evaporating off the top of the soil, off to the top of the cocoa, because it's just too hot.
Yeah.
So layer of pebbles, and you're going to get less evaporation, which is, it could be good if you want to increase humidity, but it's not good because you're trying to feed your plants, and that water's also going to, if the water's evaporating, it's going to make that nutrient solution more concentrated, which means your plants are going to have a harder time because you're putting too much nutrients in. It's also the reason why we like to put slightly less nutrients in our water when it is hotter, because the water can evaporate and it's going to concentrate everything in the pot. So cocoa, what cocoa should you go for? Canna Natural is a good cocoa. It works wonderfully. That's why it's probably, it's our biggest seller in the shop, isn't it? It's the cheapest, but it does the job. The reason it's cheap is because it's not been buffered properly. It's not been washed. It's not been buffered. What I mean by when it's not been washed,
it has been washed, but just not as many times as I would say.
As a professional cocoa?
As professional. So Canna Natural and Canna Professional, the difference between them are is one of the professionals being washed a lot more, which has got rid of...
The salts.
Yeah, the salts and
where
stuff
they get
like
the cocoa
it.
From is like, it's coconuts and coconuts. Yeah.
Both of them have been treated to get rid of like virus pests and disease and stuff like that. There's nothing like that in any of them.
Yeah.
But to just wash them a bit more.
Well, coconuts, they all come from, obviously, coconut trees, which you'll find on coasts. Yeah, I'm not joking. That's a fact. That. Coconuts come from coconut trees.
Wow.
You don't dig them up from the ground. And you'll find coconut trees on the coast.
Yeah.
And on the coast, it tends to be very salty. Yeah. So what happens with the coconut fibres is they retain a lot of sodium, Na, salt. And if you don't wash it out, then plants don't like sodium. And you'll end up burning your plants, and it'll cause lockouts, etc. So every company washes their cocoa before they put it into the bags. Yeah. But this isn't a fact, but let's say Canna Natural goes through one wash.
Yeah.
Canna Professional might get four washes.
So you
get a lot less residual salts. Yeah. The other advantage of buying a premium cocoa over a basic cocoa is that cocoa loves to hold on to calcium and magnesium and elements like that.
Yeah.
So what they do when they buffer it is they're adding calcium and magnesium to the cocoa so that when you're giving your feed, the cocoa's already saturated with calcium and magnesium. It's holding on to those, and the nutrients that you're giving to your plant are available to the plant. If your cocoa hasn't been buffered, when you add your A and your B and your other nutrients, the cocoa's immediately going and keeping hold of the calcium and magnesium.
Yeah. So and not letting go of it.
Exactly. Yeah. Ever. It holds on to it tight.
Yeah.
So if you're not really on the ball and monitoring the plants, then you can have possible calcium and magnesium issues.
Yeah.
So that's one of the things to consider. Cocoa, the DNA Mills Cocoa with Cork, just doing very, very well in the shop, doing very, very well around the UK because it's been thoroughly washed. We've done tests.
Yeah.
We went to Nottingham a few weeks ago when we started the NPK show, and the first episode where we go to Nottingham is on Friday. So make sure you're all tuned in for that on our NPK channel. With the Mills Cocoa, what we found is that it didn't have any residuals in it. It was super clean.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And there's also something else very interesting we found out about it, but I'm not going to talk about that on podcast. It's a good thing, but you're going to have to watch a YouTube show to find out what we found.
Yeah.
Yeah. Get them all over to the YouTube show.
Get to YouTube.
And subscribe, please. But the Mills Cocoa's doing very well. It's great cocoa. The cork in it just makes it really light. And on side-by-side trials with some other premium cocos, it's just outperformed massively.
It's just hands down a winner.
It is a bit more expensive. You can find it in shops between £15 to £18 per bag. And it is worth giving a go.
You say it's expensive, though, but it's what you want out of your plant, isn't it?
Yeah, it's whether some you can buy.
Tell them about the part worn tyres. Go on, say it.
The part worn tyres.
You wouldn't buy a Boss set. You wouldn't buy a Lamborghini. You wouldn't buy a Lamborghini and then go to your local garage and say, put a £25 set of part worns on that, mate.
No, you wouldn't. Use the best.
So if you've got Boss lights, Boss grip and Boss feeds
environment.
And Boss environment, make sure you use a Boss cocoa.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Do you know Boss?
And you'll get Boss results.
Do you know Boss is a Liverpool word?
Yeah.
I didn't, obviously, we just think the words we use are worldwide, but some of my mates come over from Ireland and
say,
like,
what's Boss?
What do you mean, the Boss? Who's the Boss? I'm like, no, it's Boss. Who's the Boss? Like, no, it means it's great.
But what we mean is excellent. If you've got excellent
very, very
lights,
good.
Excellent kit, excellent environment, use excellent cocoa. And DNA Mills is one of them. It is, hands down.
Then you're going to do Boss.
And you'll do excellent.
Yeah. Any other top tips or anything that you can think about with cocoa? Make sure that if you're top feeding, you're not too overzealous, use the pebbles on the top.
It's always good
to throw a little layer of pebbles at the bottom if you're bottom feeding. Ideally, you want to bottom feed into individual trays with cocoa so you can manage what each plant is drinking.
Yeah.
And a top tip, an amendment for cocoa. So when I say amendment, it's what can you add to cocoa to make it better? Eco-Thrive Chargers is one of the best.
Yeah.
Mix it all in with your cocoa and there's nothing but phenomenal results.
Yeah.
If you listen to the podcasts regularly, you'll know what Eco-Thrive Chargers. If you don't, it's basically insect poo, beetle poo that enhances the microbial activity within the cocoa and allows the plants. What we found in our own research is that when you use Eco-Thrive cocoa, if you make any mistakes, like your environment's not great or you're underwater, you're overwater,
it's a bit forgiven.
It's a bit more forgiven because the microbes are going to help with that mistake that you make. So eco-thrive cocos, eco-thrive chargers are great product to use.
The other great product is put pebbles in it, but Canada have already done it and turned up with the 60-40, haven't they? Which
what a,
is
what a lovely transition to the next product.
What a lovely. Did you like that?
I did.
Fantastic. It was excellent.
It was. Oh, shit, I dropped my phone.
I tell you what, being in this podcast with him today, mate, he's like a walking health hazard.
I don't know. We're busy. Busy, busy, busy.
Been shocking, haven't we?
60-40.
Boss product.
What's the benefit of it?
Loads of air. It's a good product. I tell you what it's great for. And you all know anyway, probably. AutoPots.
Yeah.
It's boss for that. It is
because
boss.
Of the extra air.
It's excellent.
It.
Sorry.
We're going to swap boss for excellent. Yeah. It's also excellent for flood and drain systems.
Yeah.
You wouldn't really want to use pure cocoa in a flood and drain system because it just gets too saturated, stays wet for too long.
It works well, like the V3.
V3, yeah. What was that? One mark for the V3.
Yeah, one mark for the V3.
Which it also happens to be our favourite flood and drain system.
Probably
one
of our best sellers.
It is.
Back to media.
The 60-40. So you've got to be careful because we call it 60-40 and the 60-40 we use is kind of 60-40.
Yeah.
It is 60% cocoa, 40% pebbles. But you can also get other 60-40s there, 60% pebble, 40% cocoa. So make sure you check on the bag and use one that is right for you.
Yeah.
60-40 is pretty basic. The CANNA 60-40 is very good. It's washed, it's buffered, it gets used in systems. If you do feel like you overwater and that is like one of your negative traits as a grower, give hand washing 60-40 a go because it's going to hold less water, more air pockets. It's going to be a bit more forgiving as a media.
Yeah.
So give that a little go. While we're on the subject of cocoa, let me have a quick drink and compressed cocoa.
Thoughts? There's some good ones and there's some bad ones, isn't there? The top one that we like is You Grow. That's a good one. And don't they also make one with a riso in it as well?
Yeah. Hey. You Grow XL, I think it's called. Does 70 litres.
18 litres of water will make you 70 litres of cocoa.
Yeah.
And it comes in, shoe size box. So the You Grow water, that holds about 18 litres.
Do you grow water?
Fucking, I wish I could grow water. It'd be the best water in the fucking planet. Fucking hell, protein head's gone. You Grow cocoa. Come on, Steve.
18 litres of water.
Makes 70 litres of fluffed up standard bag of cocoa. Most bags are 50 litres, aren't they?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? This makes 70 litres.
And you can walk out the shop with two bags in one hand and two bags in another hand. So that is
it's easy 280
to carry. litres that you're walking out with in your hand.
Yeah.
It is a pain in the backside to be able to get it ready. But it's better than being able to take it. It depends. If you've got a bad back and you don't want to be carrying cocoa, then the compressed cocoa is a good option.
Yeah.
And it is a nice cocoa. I'd personally stay away from the real rough looking
bricks them ones
of cocoa.
That used to get? Used to just come in a
bag. In a cardboard box and they come
and
like
they were
bricks,
just like a brick,
bricks.
Like an house brick.
Yeah, they stay away from them. They're absolutely shit. They take ages to fluff up. You're always left with little bits full of salt.
They haven't even been washed, I don't think.
It's like the crap.
I think it is just the compressed coconut.
Yeah,
right off the tree.
Yeah. I wouldn't be surprised if CANNA turned around and said, oh yeah, that compressed, it's not a CANNA product, but it's, I don't know whose product is it.
It just comes in a cardboard box.
I wouldn't be surprised if it was CANNA Naturals waste.
I haven't seen it around for a while though, that, to be honest
we
with
wouldn't,
you.
We obviously don't stock it. But I haven't even, maybe it's...
No,
it's,
but even flicking through catalogues and stuff like that, I haven't seen it.
Yeah, don't come across it. You Grow was really well priced. Yeah. So I imagine it was sort of the death bell for the really shit compressed cocoa. Comes in nice packaging, you get the same time and time again.
Yeah.
And it's easy to store for shops as well, isn't it?
Yeah.
So that's compressed cocoa. It's great if you've got a bad back. It's not that, if you compared even the best compressed cocoa though to something like CANNA Natural, it's not as good.
So, I'd stick with the CANNA Natural.
Yeah, it's what you want to get out of it.
I wouldn't change over unless I had to.
Yeah. Oh, and top tip for compressed cocoa, don't do it in the bath and then pull the bath plug out. You'll just have a... We've had a customer do it.
And the other top tip is, it says 18 litres on the back, but do yourself a favour and only put about 15 litres in to start with. And if
maybe
it's still
10.
A little bit, yeah, even 10.
And then add to it and mix it.
Because what you don't want to do is you don't want it absolutely saturated, because
you'll spend it forever drying it out.
Yeah, that's just you can't put it right in your pot and put your plants in it, you know what I mean? Otherwise, it's just like over water, and again, there's nothing in it.
Yeah. The next bullet point we've got is pebbles. So we talked about 60-40. It went from Coco to 60-40. Now let's just talk about pebbles. But while we're talking about pebbles, pebbles are pretty. A pebble is a pebble. You get round pebbles, and you get pebbles that are slightly misshapen. Yeah. What they say about the misshapen pebbles is that it creates more air pockets because perfectly round pebbles, they all, after you give them a bit of a shake, they all fall into a nice arrangement. Whereas misshapen pebbles, there's no nice arrangement they can fall into. So there's always plenty of air spaces. Yeah. If you're getting deep into it when you start talking about air spaces within misshapen pebbles, because I just really don't think it made that much of a difference. There's plenty of air spaces between
whether
any
it was
pebbles.
Round or, yeah, that's it.
I think it could just be a good marketing technique. Misshapen pebbles in Coco, it is what it is. If you can get it for cheaper, happy days. But
if you can't, it wouldn't be bothered.
But with pebbles, you've also got other innate medias, and you've got things like vermiculite, perlite, ericaceous earth, which is you can also be called diatomaceous, and it's that volcanic rock dust that we use. What we call it. I've just called it all the fancy names and a bag of, tell me, buddy.
You've lost me.
What do we call it?
I forgot the name of it.
I've just told you all like the fancy name, ericaceous earth, diatomaceous. What do we call it? And it's the bag of red stones.
Hydromist.
That's it. We call it hydromist.
DWC shite.
DWC shite. With the hydromist, it's the same as diatomaceous earth. It's always full of crap.
Yeah. So that needs washing there.
Wash and wash and wash. And
you
wash,
could keep
and
washing
wash,
until them stones are gone, though, you know.
Yeah, yeah, if you keep on shaking it
or putting your hands into it and doing it will just keep...
They'll rub against each other. Yeah, and it just keeps going. Just keep going. So what we do is put a few holes in the bottom of the bag, put a big hole in the top of the bag, if it comes in bags for you, and throw a hose pipe in the top and just let it all run up the bottom. Yeah. If not, get something like similar to...
A sieve.
Your net pot that you're putting the actual pebbles in, the actual... hydromist in will work, put it into the pot and just get a shower head over it or just rinse till the water turns.
I'll put that, like you've just said, into the net pot. I'll rinse it and then I will turn it with my hands.
Yeah.
And then I'll rinse it again. Yeah. And then I'll leave it. Then I'll rinse it again. Then I'll leave it. Then I'll rinse it again. Yeah. And I'll try my best not to deserve it. But I'll rinse that about five or six times, I will.
The reason it's so important is, one, you want to get rid of all that dust that could potentially clog up a plant's root systems. And also, if you're in a system where you're using that type of hydromiss and there's any sort of pumps, air pumps, water pumps, that basically what it is clay. Yeah. It's fine clay, sediment, and it'll fall to the bottom of your DWC tank. It can end up blocking your pumps. So you best get rid of it.
If you don't do it as well, if you don't wash it out properly and you put it into your system, you fill your system up with nutrients and then you turn the drippers on, if it runs through, you can end up looking at it an hour later and
it's just orange.
It's just orange water and you think, oh my God.
I should have just spent the day washing
it. Spent an extra few hours just cleaning that out, because what you've done is you've just spent an hour filling up your water button for what?
Yeah. As well as that, you've got vermiculite and perlite, pretty similar in terms of what you're using for. Yeah. We use perlite. There's a lot of people that say perlite dust causes cancer. It's actually a myth. Perlite dust is non-carcinogenic. However, it's not good to breathe the shit in. So don't be panicked by if there's a bit of a plume of dust, obviously you don't want to breathe it in, but it's not carcinogenic.
Yeah.
Just don't breathe it in, because you don't want to put that type of shit on your lungs. But don't be panicked by it. Don't not buy it because you think it's carcinogenic. Just, it's always good to put a little bit of a mask on so you're not inhaling dust. But perlite and vermiculite, a little bit less dusty, but we find that perlite tends to be the bigger seller. Yeah. We don't sell much vermiculite anymore, do we?
No.
What they're used for, a lot of people mix it in with the soil to help aerate the soil a little bit. What we use it for and what we like is when you've got your propagator trays.
Yeah, fill your propagator tray.
Exactly. And then put your jiffies on top.
And then your jiffies
or your rock walls.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then what happens is, especially on the heated trays, if you put a heat mat underneath, what a lot of people do is put the jiffy in the propagator and then put a heat mat underneath. And what happens with heat mats is that they'll heat up areas, they'll have hot spots. So some parts of the propagator will be cool, some of the jiffies will burn, and you'll absolutely burn your plants. When you put an inch and a half perlite on the bottom of your propagator, soak them thoroughly. Yeah. But that's a good way to keep your propagate at misted up and high humidity. It also means that they're not going to burn. So when you've got a heater underneath,
and it will all your jiffies up as well.
Yeah,
they're a nightmare to stand up. They just roll around in the propagator, don't they? So it'll.
So it's a nice method for using in propagation, but for making light would work. So get whatever.
And if you spill anything in your grow room, just put perlite on it and it'll absorb it straight away.
Yeah.
We've had to do that many a times in our lab, haven't we, Steve? Would you?
We have. Taps get left on.
Yeah. Oh.
Any other innate mediums that I'm not thinking of? Vermiculite, perlite, a little bit of diatomaceous earth. Top tip for diatomaceous earth, I've just thought with Coco, is if you tend to have thrips and pest and fungus gnats, then diatomaceous earth on a microscopic level is like glass, like shards of glass. Yeah. And when they crawl over, it just rips the body to bits. Yeah. So if you sprinkle a little bit of diatomaceous earth on the top of your Coco, it does the same thing as pebbles, acts as a mulch, stops evaporation of water, and also insects can't crawl along it. So it's good insect preventative. In the summer, top tip, loads of insects, throw some diatomaceous earth over the top of your Coco or your soil. Yeah. We just mentioned the rock walls and the propagators. Rock walls and jiffies. What's your favourite for cuttings and clones?
Jiffies.
Do you like jiffies?
I like jiffies. Reg would kill me for saying that because you know what Reg loves? Root riots.
Does he?
Loves them.
Yeah.
But I can use them all.
Yeah, yeah.
But if you had to say to me...
I'd say there isn't a best.
We're going in the lab. I'd say get jiffies.
What are we doing cuttings into?
Jiffies.
Get the jiffies. Easily transportable.
Easily transportable, easy to use.
With a bit of water.
Yeah.
And they do, and then it's made of cocoa. A jiffy is just a compressed piece of cocoa. Yeah. And when you put it into soaking into water, it expands. You put your cutting in or your seed, and it's just nice. It comes with a little bit of a cloth around
like
the outside.
A tea bag, isn't it?
Yeah. And then you can pot that up into cocoa and you're away.
And you're done.
But there is no, my personal opinion between jiffy and between Rockwell, there's no test that you could do that could say this is the best. There's probably one that's better suited for an environment like I'd say maybe a jiffy is better for a slightly less humid environment because it's going to hold a little bit more water. In my experience, the rock walls tend to lose water a little bit quicker. What do you find that? Or
I think everyone's different, like you said. I think it's all different environments, and it's just what you get used to using. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
I like jiffies, they're cheap and cheerful.
If it works for you, carry on using it.
Yeah, that's it.
If you're not, it's not working for you, try something else. Or try a Rockwell. Yeah. Or if you're Reg, try Root Riot. Yeah. Root Riots are good though.
The pre-moistened and that. Yeah,
yeah, and they come in their own little tray when you buy the packs of 24.
Yeah, that's it.
Rockwells, top tip: you no longer have to pH the Rockwells. They've stopped using the limestone as a binding agent.
Have they?
So it doesn't shoot your pH up. So if you, like, while I was working in the lab ready to do an episode for season one, I was doing the introduction video, soaked the rock walls in water for 24 hours, came back the next day, checked the pH, and the pH had changed. I'm like, wow, this is really weird. And then Everest Fernandez on his channel, literally the week after, did a big rock wall episode saying, they've changed the ingredients, you no longer need to pH your rock walls. However, having said that, it just feels nice to put rock walls into a pH 5.8 water
and leave them to soak. Yeah.
And then you just, I don't know, just feels good.
Yeah.
Just feels good to do that. So my advice or opinion is you don't have to, but it just feels nice to do it. So crack on. What else could I say for rock walls for a top tip? If you struggle,
I still, like you said about the perlite with the jiffies, but it doesn't matter what root riot jiffies, I still put the perlite in the bottom because it helps with the humidity in the propagator.
It does. I'm just trying to think of that tip where people cut the rock wall in half to put the, so to not damage, if they'll take a cutting and they'll cut the rock wall in half, put the cutting inside the rock wall,
and shut it.
Close it, and then put an elastic band around it.
Oh, that's just too much time and effort, mate.
Or that could be when they're removing the cutting if they don't want to continue using the rock wall. Yeah. But it's a bit of a mad technique. Let me know if you used to do that, or if there's any techniques you use for propagating and use rock walls, jiffies. Give a little comment below or send us in
some tips,
direct messages. Yeah, me and Barry know fuck all. So let's move on to.
We were talking about Coco before, though, but we missed one out. Atami.
Well, it's a special one, isn't it?
It's 80% Coco, 20% soil, isn't it?
I got corrected about a year and a half ago when I said, there's no such, because people come in and they ask for Coco soil.
Yeah.
Like, there's no such thing as Coco soil. Stop asking for it. Like, what do you want, Coco or soil? And I did a big podcast on it. But I got corrected. Somebody I think it was actually Century Grow Systems got in touch with me, Dave from Century, and said that it's actually got a little bit of soil in it. Yeah. So it is technically.
Isn't the soil in soil. There for the reason of it holds a bit of nutrients and it's in there? So the very first feed that you give your plants is just water.
Exactly. And it's already got that feed in there. So if you just want to put your cuttings, your seedlings in there, then it's already got some food in there. So you just literally have to just give it water for about a week or 2 weeks and then slowly start introducing your own feed into the cocoa. Yeah. But Tommy, very good cocoa.
Nice.
I'm a bit shame about the bags. Because you had lovely bags.
You had nice bags and now you've changed them.
To like these mad pink and purple with all colourful. They look lovely, but Jesus, draw attention to a bag of cocoa. Fucking, I know you're trying to stand out here, but we like the discreet
packaging. It's like something you'd see in B&Q.
Yeah, and it just makes it look mad, doesn't it? Makes it look like John Innes now. And we like just plain packaging.
Yeah.
Your cocoa was great. The packaging is just fucking shouting out dead loud now. So we have to double bin bag it. So none of that cocoa spills all over your car boot. Soil is the next one though.
I haven't used it for years.
Yeah, I use it when I know I'm not going to be able to give as much time and attention to my plants. If I'm doing organic, it's in soil.
Yeah.
If I can't spend as much time as I know that I would need to, it goes into soil. Soil's great, brilliant for beginners. Because it allows you to make lots of mistakes. Yeah. It'll help you buffer with your pH. It'll help buffer your EC. So if you put too much feed in, it'll take it in.
It's great as a beginner thing, isn't it?
Yeah, if you don't put enough feed in, then there's feed already in the soil. And the reason behind it is cation exchange capacity. And what that means, it's called CEC. You might see it on the bags. Essentially, what cocoa loves to do is hold on to negative electrons. So with soil, it's cation exchange capacity is a lot more fluid. So whereas cocoa loves to hold on to nutrients, not give them back, soil has got a better cation exchange capacity where it'll freely give nutrients away. And it doesn't hold on to too much nutrients either in a negative way. It'll hold on to them, but then freely allow the plant to take them back up. So again, really, really good for beginners. Very good for potting up early stages, so you don't have to bother with feed. You can just water.
Yeah.
And the downside is you don't tend to get the yields with soil. Cocoa's much better. It's not inert in a chemical sense, but it's compared to soil.
You know what, in cocoa, you know what you're giving them. Do you know what I mean? Where soil's holding on to a lot more, and you do have problems with soil, don't you? Where people will tend to feed them. Let's say you're feeding your plant every 2 days now. People will tend to feed them with feed every 2 days.
Yeah.
And then it's just a build-up. It doesn't need to be like that. If I feed soil, I feed it. Correct me if I'm wrong. Everyone's different, though. Let's say I fed on a Monday with nutrients into my soil. Then I wouldn't feed them again with nutrients probably until, let's say, the Sunday. Yeah. I'll give them water after that.
Yeah.
Another two waters. So maybe a feed, two or three waters, a feed, two or three waters,
and if
a feed.
It looks as though it could want a little bit more nutrition.
You'd give it a little bit more, you'd step it up a little bit.
But
you'd have got to be careful with it.
Perfect in the summer. In the winter, you'd want to maybe just give it an extra feed, maybe two feeds a week. And again, with soil, you've got that capacity to not make a mistake, but it's not going to punish you as hard as cocoa will. And then again, water, just water, like a DWC will absolutely punish you if you get
that'll finish it in about 12 hours. That,
yeah, if that pump, if an oxygen pump goes off or the water runs out 24 hours,
or you get a flood, you're done.
Finished,
you're done.
So, soil, great for beginners, brilliant for organics. And if you know you're not going to be able to,
great for people
time,
who know what they're doing with it, though. It is,
yeah.
You can't miss that out. It is great,
yeah.
It's probably one of the first things around, and it'll probably be one of the last things around, too,
yeah, on planet Earth.
It will.
It's great if you, it's just brilliant for organics because obviously your microbes are really helping soil. If you are using soil, using beneficials is just a brilliant idea as well, because it'll help unlock everything that, it'll just help move things along with soil as well. Some, what do you call them now, brands of soil. We do really well with All Mix and Light Mix. Really good. It's from BioBiz. They're two of the best performing soils in our shop. You got Dutch Pro Soil.
Yeah,
good standard soil. Yeah, it's okay. Yeah. And then you've got the high quality soil, the CANNA Terra Professional Plus.
Yeah,
it's just a very, very good soil, top notch. There are other soils out there, but I'm just talking about the ones that we particularly sell well in our shop. they're the medias. So what sort of, you've written some points down to mention to people that are using all medias. Excuse me. Rough pH on all. So Coco, 5.8.
Oh, I'll beg to differ.
What do you do?
I do 5.5, mate. I do.
Yeah.
And that's, people now be agree- people out there now be turning it down saying, full of shit.
No agrees with you. I've just, that's just a long ingrained thing. I do 5.5 in water, 5.8 in cocoa, 6 in soil. You know who agrees with you? Jason from AutoPot. He's like 5.5 in water, 5.5 in cocoa, and then you can take it to 6 in soil.
Yeah. That's me.
Absolutely.
That's
right.
me, mate.
Yeah, perfect. Just one of those things I've always done. I don't know why. A bit more in the middle, because in water, the drift and pH can happen a bit quicker, so I set it at 5.5. Yeah. In cocoa, the drift and pH, if it's a well-buffered cocoa, is a bit slower, so I just set it at 5.8, but 5.5.
I just set it at 5.5, and I know it is going to creep up on me, you know what I mean? So the plant, as it's creeping up, the plant can take them bits out of it, what it needs and what it wants at them times.
Yeah, I got a message actually with somebody saying, we were talking last week about pH, and he said, yeah, my pH always does rise, but on occasions, it has dropped, and it wasn't pythium. I didn't have pythium, didn't have smelly roots. It was all good. What else could it have been? And what I forgot to say is, I'd say 90% of the time it's pythium. If your pH is dropping and it's not pythium, and you can guarantee that it's not pythium, then what the plants do is that if they're under attack by pest, then they will, and these are pests that are mostly around the soil, so root pests, fungus, gnats, and sometimes when the pests are attacking the plant, then the plant will actually lower the pH of the surrounding media because the pests don't like an acidic environment.
Yeah.
So the plant will actually itself try and lower its root pH to try and dissuade the pests from actually feeding on it. That's in some cases, that's what's happening. So probably it's the plant trying to piss off the pests so they don't eat it. So that's to answer that question. Thank you very much for sending that to me as well. Now, feeding techniques. Cocoa hand feeding. Don't be going mad with the top. If you're a top feeder, just a drizzle is lovely.
I can't bear to see these people who just go in and go whack and throw it straight on
a
the
litre
top.
A litre of water in half a second.
Oh, it's no good, mate. You've got to tease it.
Yeah.
You've got to tease it. You know what I mean?
What, do you put like a little dress on your measuring on your litre jug?
No, I walk up to it, look. I go up to it with the jug and I go, And then do you know what I do? Feed the next plant next to it, so it thinks, wow, what are you doing?
Best produce some meal, otherwise you won't get anything.
No, but it is the same as like what you were saying before about putting the pebbles and stuff like that on the top. If you just whack it in, you see it just go and go down the pot.
My cocoa?
So just go slow. Yeah. Not in a rush.
Yeah. You shouldn't be anyway. You should be taking your time with your plants.
Yeah, man.
In soil, we don't tend to bottom feed soil, top feed soil. The wicking activity in soil is not as good as in cocoa, so you could potentially have a few problems if you're bottom feeding soil. To prefer a top feed, but plants and soil in auto pots also do well.
Yeah,
just a bit more perlite in them. So I prefer top feed. I'm sure people would say I've always bottom fed soil and they've done great, brilliant for you.
Yeah.
It's just I prefer to top feed with soil.
60-40 again. You can top feed with bottom feed. With an auto pot, you top feed until you reach it at the bottom, and then I wouldn't give it anything over the top.
With auto pots, tease it till it's at the bottom, and then whack that
and
tap
then
on
that's
the
it,
way.
And you're done.
Yeah. Top tip for auto pots: don't leave the tap on constantly. I like to give them a dry period for a day. Let them use the water. Let the roots go searching, then turn the tap back on.
That's like another podcast all in itself auto pots. I love auto pots, mate. I do. Yeah. Love them. You know what I mean?
Full podcast on them, though, isn't it?
It's a full podcast for the top tips for that, mate. But it's all positives with auto pots.
With coco and rock walls, a good technique to use, and this is a massive technique over in America, is drippers.
Yeah.
It's an advanced technique. There's a lot that can go wrong. Pipes can block, pumps can fail, drippers may pop out.
Yeah.
But if you do it right, it's a really efficient technique of feeding your plants. It's pretty hard to overwater if you get the feeding times right. One of the best drippers that we sell is called the Octometer.
Yeah.
Rather than having a 2 litre per hour blue dripper or a 4 litre per hour green dripper,
it actually has like a little valve on it, a little tap, doesn't it?
Yeah, and it's multifunctional. You throw it in and you tune. You can basically tune each plant if you think under the plant wants a bit more. You turn it up. You're not having to change drippers.
That's what happens in a grow room anyway, Steve. That's what that is what happens in a grow room. You never end up with everything the same. One's always a bit stronger and you... It's like a litter of puppies. One's a monster and there's always a runt in there, isn't there? Which is, that's what they say, don't they? There's always a runt in a litter. Yeah. You know what I mean? Well, it is the same in a grow room. You'll always have one plant where you think, wow, that's a monster, that.
Yeah, I'm going to turn it up a little bit.
Yeah, that one can handle a bit more. You know what I mean? Oh, that's my phone, though.
I told you to put that on silent, didn't I? Does that ancient piece of brickware have a silent function on it?
It doesn't, mate.
Oh, well. You just have to turn it off then, aren't you? You stop being so popular, Barry. So, there's a company called Floorflex. They smash it in the US. They haven't really quite made it in the UK. It seems like quite a complicated system to set up for your hobbyist, your medium grower, but the commercial fellas in the US are smashing it with Floorflex. Yeah. Just type in Floorflex on Google, you see some amazing setups.
Yeah. It is a good system, I've seen it.
Mm. Feeding and other feeding techniques. You got drippers, you got hand feeding. Systems like multiflow, it's a flood and drain like multiflow. It's a 60-40. Feeding times directed by you, the grower, depends on the environment. The multiflow V3 has got a learning cycle. Yeah. Do not panic when the learning cycle can take up to 50 minutes. It's learning. Yeah. So it's going to figure out how many pots you've got, how much it needs to feed.
It keeps taking water bit by bit until it knows, nah, there's no more water going anywhere yet. So that cocoa must be soaked and then it'll drain back. Then it knows how much it needs.
So don't panic on the multiflow. But I've also heard learning cycle.
Good things about DNA mills in the multiflow and in the AutoPot.
Yeah.
I know we say 60-40 with the pebble and that, but DNA mills is doing well in it as well, because it's a fluffy cocoa.
So have you heard people using DNA mills?
Yeah, man, I've heard loads of people, in a flood and drain as well, mate, and they're getting good results out of them as well, you know what I mean?
Happy days. Another notch on the belt for DNA mills. Cocoa, yeah.
Well done, James.
Yeah, and mills. The other systems you can use, I think that's pretty much for media. That's you got. What else have you got? The NFT tables you use in rock walls that you can't change.
The hydromist and stuff like that. You either DWC bubblers and stuff like that, aren't you?
If you are in a system 60-40, a bit more forgiving. Pebbles, you have to flood and drain a lot. Quite often because you've always got to keep them roots moist. So it could be a feed every half an hour. Like it could be a watering cycle every half an hour or every hour.
Be a dripper,
Or with flood and drain, it's probably going to be when they're young, one feed every day or one feed every 2 days, and then just slowly build it up to peak flower. They could be taking 3, maybe even 4 flood and drains a day.
Yeah, that's in 60-40 and cocoa. In just pebble, it'd be a lot more, wouldn't it?
Yeah, a lot more. And so,
how many times a day would you in pebble in a V3 or
in a
let's
V3,
just say
you'd be doing it? You'd want a quick flood and drain and. You'd probably want it maybe twice an hour, depending on how many pots you've got. If it takes you 40 minutes to completely flood a 48 pot,
if you've got a big system,
you'll want that doing it constantly. Flood, then maybe a 15-minute break, flood and drain. Flood and drain. With pebbles, it's essentially, it's not DWC, but it could be like that because it's got nothing to rely on. It's all about the water. So it's as hard to manage as a DWC system. Yeah. You put down the right media for you. That's a top tip, really, isn't it?
It is, isn't it? And like you said before about soil being dead forgiven, and that will cocoa's a bit
less forgiven.
And DWC is not forgiven at all. Made that old nothing back.
Smack your bitch up straight away with DWC.
So it is about picking, can you be there constantly? Have you got the time to do it in cocoa? Have you got the time to do DWC? You've just got to make that decision yourself.
What's right for
every media has got a different feed that goes with it, with different feeding techniques, like we said before. But
how much time can you spend with your plants?
Exactly.
If it's not a lot, you might want to go soil.
You might want to go soil because you can leave them that little bit longer.
And if you're going to treat them like your absolute babies, then you can go DWC and pH and EC and water temperature and dissolved oxygen.
And sleeping bag.
Sleeping bag right next to you. Then you can benefit from the CO2 you produce from your mouth. So yeah, choose the right media for you. There's no, with nutrients as well, there's no right and wrong. There's no best nutrients. No. So listen, this is a top
tip.
I don't believe that.
There's no.
From Vitalink, which is in inverted commas, the cheap nutrient, all the way up to the one of the most expensive, I can't think, your high top end, your hydrotops.
Yeah.
Your mills, your CANNA, potentially expensive
Advanced
nutrients.
Advanced nutrients, everything.
they all work for different reasons for different people.
Yeah.
Vitalink
and people get
shit.
Different things out of different nutrients.
Yeah. And the most expensive isn't necessarily the best. So if this is a top tip from me, from grow shop owner to customers, if you go into your grow shop and say to them, "What's the best nutrients? What's the best nutrients on your shelf?" and they give you a set of nutrients, then they are trying to sell you something. They're not after your best
because
interests.
They should say.
Ask
they should
you
make
questions.
It for, yeah, ask you
Jesus
questions
Christ,
and say,
yeah.
"Well,
what are
what
you doing?
Do you want out of it?
Yeah, what you want yeah. out of it? Are you an organic grower? Are you looking to produce spinach on a mass level so you can sell to restaurants? Are you in the middle where you want really good quality tomatoes, but also you want the high yield so you can feed your family and you enjoy tomatoes? It's different for everybody. You're somewhere on this scale from full organic, where all you want is pure quality for you and your family or your friends. And on the other end of the scale, you just want to produce as much as possible. So you've got to start thinking about how much your nutrients costs, how quickly you can produce, all that sort of stuff. So go into your grow shop and ask the question, what is the best nutrient for me? Or don't even say for me, just say, what is the best nutrient?
Yeah.
If
and
they,
just see
if
what
they give
replies.
You something, find another grow shop.
Yeah.
Because you're not getting the best advice. If they turn around and they say something like, if they say this, there's no best nutrient. It depends what you want to achieve. Yeah. You're in a good grow shop and they're more than likely going to look after you as a grower. So use that as I call it a litmus test. Use that as your litmus test to see if you're in a good grow shop and see what they're saying. Because you may walk, and if they promote one brand, then it's either because the friend owns the company
or the markups
are great on it. Or they've got loads of stock and they want to get rid of it.
Yeah.
Don't be duped into bad grow shops. Let the really good ones do well.
And they're there to be quizzed over nutrients.
Yeah,
so
ask
them when they put them bottles in front of you, say, well, why aren't you giving me them? And what's the difference between that one and that one and that one and that one? Irrelevant from price. What's the difference? Forget about the price for a minute. What's the difference with them? How come you've got 10 sets of A and B, let's say. Well, what's the differences with them all? Mm-hmm. And then maybe you'll get it out of them. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Of that's quality, that's yield and quality, that's nothing. That's shite.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It's shite, it's probably cheap. Yeah. When we say
when he says it's shite,
it's not,
that just means it doesn't work for him.
Else.
And it doesn't, it's not the best compared to everything else and people.
I'm going to use Vitalink as an example because it is a cheaper range of nutrients and people turn around and go, well, that's shit. But we've had a customer that used what did he use? He used a can of A&B and the buddy. The buddy is super cheap and he was made up with his results absolutely over the moon and might do some good products. So that was what was right for him. Now, if we listen to this customer who did the best off can of A&B and the Vitalink buddy, then we should then turn around to every grower and say, no, this is the best our mate said.
But
so
that's what I mean. How deep you can get into it is, see him as used Canada A&B and Vitalink buddy.
Yeah.
He could have had a top environment.
Exactly.
Now the next person that comes in might not have a top environment and take them same nutrients and get a shite result.
Yeah, could do. So it is what I'll say about this. If you've got a brilliant environment and the lowest quality nutrients you can possibly get your hands on,
well.
You will do better than somebody with a shite environment
with top.
Their best nutrients you can possibly get on this planet Earth. It's all about the environment, 100%. So buy the right food for you, for the right, and also you put there for the right media as well.
Yeah.
Make sure that you get a Coco A&B for
Coco.
Make sure you're getting a Terra, a soil feed for soil. Right. Making sure you're getting a hydro feed for hydro.
Or like a run to waste feed.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Those systems like run to waste now is like, not a lot of people use them, but if you are using run to waste, make sure you're getting the higher concentrated nutrients.
It's not just A and B that runs through everything.
So we've pretty much, you've put top tip, haven't you? Pebble 1.5 inch of pot and Coco, not feeding soil with feed every time as it holds nutrients and systems that media works. And we've pretty much covered all of that.
Yeah.
Can you think of any more top tips for people that are buying media and are media growers? I think we've covered quite a bit there.
Don't just run in and buy the cheap one.
Yeah. If you want to buy the cheap one,
it still works well.
Buy a CalMag.
Yeah.
Buy a CalMag. Buy the cheap Coco. Buy a CalMag. Make up a weak half strength solution and pour it all through your Coco. And that is essentially your buffer and your media. Yeah. if you want to do that work, then you're going to buy a £20 bottle. Just
you're going to buy a £20 bottle of Calmag, isn't it?
Yeah, and if you've got loads, if you've got loads of the cocoa that's not buffered, then it might work out for you because you can end up doing 20 bags. If you're going to buy the Calmag bottle to buffer 2 bags of natural,
yeah,
then just buy the good fucking cocoa.
Yeah,
right? And if you're buying high end nutrients, don't go for the cheap cocoa. If you go on high quality, then try and get as high quality as possible. If you're going cheap, then doesn't matter. Go cheap. It's all what's right for you.
And at least you're going cheap and having a go.
Yeah, yeah. And your grow shop should support you in whatever you want to do. Don't be forced into buying anything
because they don't like it.
Yeah, because they don't like it or they don't make profit margins on it.
Do you or it's got research? Dust on it because it's sat there for a while.
Yeah. And on the other, put the shoe on the other foot. Don't listen to your mate because your mate does well with this, and this. And he's been doing it for 5, 10, 15 years and he's always got great results. You are a different person.
Right.
Stand on your own 2 feet, do your own research and find what's best for you. Yeah, and that's what I'll finish the podcast on.
Yeah, man.
So we're going to choose. Actually, I want everyone to go and subscribe to the YouTube channel, please. Okay? Follow us on Instagram at NPK.
Do it now, and we'll wait.
Yeah, okay. So me and Barry are just going to wait here for a minute while you go and subscribe. Oh, what was... Yeah.
You
still haven't subscribed. You lazy bastards. Just go and subscribe. And we'll see you next week.
Yeah, man.
See you later. Don't forget to watch episode 1 of the NPK show, season 2, Friday, 6 o'clock.
Yeah, man.
See you later.
See you all later.
Bye-bye.
Bye.